and today designing modern board games based on George Filley's forthcoming book, A Class in Board Game Design, Lecture 20, Hex and Counter Board Wargames.
Today, we are going to move on to something substantially different in the discussion. What we are going to do for the next few lectures, interspersed with holidays, project presentation day, labs, etc., is to discuss what are known technically as hex and counter board wargames. Board wargames are sort of not the same as Eurogames because the shape of Eurogames substantially excludes military topics. In contrast, the point of board wargames is wargaming. Now, as a practical issue, most of you are going into the computer game industry, and if you look at a random sample of computer games, you will discover large amounts of mayhem, blood, gore, violence, things pretending to be strategy and tactics. The important issue from the perspective of this topic is that board game designers, because they can't hide behind graphics or weird coding or anything, actually have to be creative and do a good job of writing rules. And they have to write rules that give you interesting games. They have to write rules that can be understood because there's no computer to do the work for the players. And they have, to some extent, to be creative. There are a bunch of places you can look that are worth staring at as other books on board type war games. I would in particular note Sabin's book is Simulating War. Sabin teaches at King's College London in the Department of War Studies. He sees two particular uses for board war games. First of all, he has all of these students who, pretty much like you, know very little or nothing about actual military warfare tactics, strategy, logistics, or anything else. And so within the constraint of his course, he has two-hour laboratories. And the notion of having people play games outside of class does not arise. So he has to design games that run to completion, that actually illustrate issues, and he's got a book on it. He also proposes, but doesn't give any concrete examples, that in principle, board wargaming ought to be an effective tool of the historian. That it's very nice to say, well, if the Confederates had captured Little Round Top at the Battle of Gettysburg, the Union Army would have had challenges. Of course, if you know something about the history, you know what the answer is, because the Union Army had actually planned to fight the battle at Pipe's Mills. Not at Gettysburg at all. Nonetheless, if you do war games, you can manage, perhaps, to do some historical studies. The next author I would note is Perla, The Art of Wargaming. Perla talks about war games from an entirely different perspective, the actual military perspective, where you are trying to do simulations to test techniques, weapons, doctrine against what you think other people will do. Perla notes that if you look at the history of World War II in the Pacific, that was the Navy's war basically, almost everything that happened except the surprise attack at the start of the war had been gamed and simulated in considerable detail. So the various issues associated with, logistics, beach landings, where you could go, where it was not useful to try capturing territory, had all been gamed out. Then, of course, James F. Dunnigan, here, the country's premier board wargame designer, has given us his encyclopedia of board wargame design, and his volume, which, by the way, is free on the internet, is very much worth reading to get a perspective that is not the same as the perspective in the book I gave you. I would also skip ahead, since there is some overlap, I would note John Peterson playing at the World. It's only 700 large pages of small print. It is primarily a history of the creation and existence of role-playing games up until 1980 or so. And so it's definitely worth reading if you want background. Now, what is the point of all this? Well, if you say the point of war games in a certain sense is we are going to have games that are supposed to actually resemble warfare. And in fact, there are people who wander, otherwise sane people, who wander about referring to board war games as conflict simulations or historical conflict simulations or other words to the same thing. And these are the people who have something resembling historical accuracy as their objective. There are other people, people who are looking for a good game, who have very different objectives. Now, we can say that's the objective, and the question is, how do you deliver this as an objective? And I am going to go back to the representations I started out talking about early in the term, and I will point out three sorts of representations and how they come into war games. And one are basically toy soldiers with real rules. And the notion of giving, fighting out battles with toy soldiers, except detailed rules, you can move a figure so much, is due to H.G. Wells, who was an English socialist and libertine and science fiction author. On rare occasion, for example, in the War of the Worlds, his gaming creeps in, and the misfortune of the territorial artillery when it opens fire too soon, you can hear the rattle of the dice in his rules. So Wells gave us toy soldiers. The next option, which is actually even older, is what is called a free Kriegspiel. That is, you have a big map, and you have several copies of it, one for each side and one for the referee. And you shove wooden blocks across the map as if they were military units marching or deploying into battle formation or shooting at each other. But when you ask, what is going to happen, you have senior military officers, some of whom had actually seen battles. There weren't a lot of wars in Europe in the period when this was developed. And they would look at this and they would say what the outcome was. this is basically a role-playing game with a games master or crew of games masters. Except instead of the individual blocks representing single people waving swords, they represent columns of 500 or 2,000 men. You see, it's a role-playing game, except you're playing a few extra characters more than you usually would. And the third answer is the board war game, you can find antecedents, that is, things that you can show have the fundamental properties of being a board war game that go back to the middle late 19th century. But they were sort of, here is this isolated game that someone sold. There were no more games in the family. It's this idea that surfaced and then sank again without a trace. The actual father of modern board wargaming is indubitably Charles Roberts and his games Tactics and Tactics 2. Now, Roberts was a National Guard officer, and he had the idea, which actually was the idea of the original Kriegspiel authors, of creating a board war game which would allow military officers to understand the challenges faced at the upper levels of command. However, he didn't have a staff of referees handy. He knew his players wouldn't. So he designed the game, and he put into the rules engines, the rules, what would happen under various circumstances so that the sorts of contingencies that could actually come up were all covered. That's what Roberts did. It was a very clever idea. And he sold Tactics. He put an ad for Tactics 2 into Scientific American, which is where I first saw it. He produced a game, Gettysburg, which had the interesting feature there was a light version with a paper map. So they sold at Gettysburg, and now you have a map of the real battlefield. And they sold a huge number of copies. So Roberts actually solved or recognized and provided crude rules for most of the issues that you would now find in board wargaming. Okay, so having done this little historical sketch, what is the fundamental difference between a board war game and more or less, but not quite all, computer games? And the answer is, all of the rules are out there. All of the numbers associated with each unit are out there. As a result, and this is the point of my two books on Stalingrad, as a result, you can do detailed calculations, even as you can do detailed calculations if you're playing chess or Go or checkers or whatever, and therefore it becomes very much a game of skill. Because there are no hidden numbers, there aren't mysterious questions, why did my units just blow up when for no apparent reason? Everything is there in the rules so you can understand what's going on, and therefore you get games of tactics coming out. Okay, so there's the history, and that's the first piece. And now, having said these things are sometimes called conflict simulations, the first question you should ask, if you say you're going to generate a game that simulates a battle, the first question is whether this is even vaguely possible. And there are several lines of argumentation to say, well, it might be possible, but it's not quite as trivial as it sounds. For example, here we are, game set in ancient Greece, and here comes the army of Xerxes marching towards the Battle of Marathon, and they're going to lose. Well, how big is the army of Xerxes? And depending on your source, it was 15,000 men or 50,000 men, or maybe 500,000 men, you notice there's a little historical disagreement as to how many people he had. If you crank forward towards the present, well, if you get forward to, say, Marlborough, that's early, mid-18th century, well, 1700 sort of period anyhow. If you get forward to Marlborough, you actually have counts of how many men showed up on a given day, and those counts were reasonably accurate. However, if you ask who were the people fighting in his army, we have the names of perhaps a half dozen enlisted men. On the other hand, if you come forward to World War I or World War II and you wanted complete accuracy, you can actually find out, though you may have to do a fair amount of research, every single name of every single soldier in at least most armies, some of the armies will be a little flaky, and where they were on each day, and what their state of health was, and so on and so forth. And so there's a huge amount of historical data out there. Interpreting it, however, is a challenge. Anyone interested in World War I or World War II should indubitably start with the Mearsheimer book on Liddell Hart. The essence of Mearsheimer's book is that large amounts of the history of World War, military history of World War II and I, were severely distorted by the work of one English historian who wrote very copiously and was very convincing and had as one of his important efforts covering up his severe bad advice at the start of the war as to how the war should be fought. It could also be proposed that by vigorously working to keep England from fielding a large army at the start of World War II, he allowed the Nazis to beat the French, when if the British had done what they might have done, World War II would have been somewhat shorter and less unpleasant for our side. So that's Mearsheimer. We may also consider the interesting issue of the bow and the gun, and the question of why archery was replaced by gunpowder weapons, and when, and what the reasons were. Now, the usual statement you can find in many sources is that, well, if you want a good archer, you need to train them, and the training takes years and years and decades of shooting at targets every Sunday. Now, one athletic event a week will not even maintain muscle tone, let alone improve it. You should be a little suspicious of this already. Also, the notion that people peak athletically in their 40s and 50s, I'm sure many of you have noticed the vast number of NBA and NFL players who are in their 40s and 50s, right? Well, of course not. That's not how human beings work. However, C.V. Oman, who was an English 19th century historian, was out there in fair part to push the idea of how England was the greatest country in the history of the world, and the whole purpose of history was to converge on the glory of England. I am being a little unfair to him, but not very much. And so he would go on at great length about wonderful English crossbowmen, longbowmen. The actual answer appears to be that heavy infantry armor, not the very light armor that the French had at Agincourt and Crecy, could not be penetrated by a longbow except at point-blank range. Firearms could blow holes in armor, and therefore firearms were superior. If you crank forward to the American Revolution, though, no one was wearing armor. And at that point, the longbow had a superior accurate range by a lot, a vastly superior rate of fire, and therefore you sort of wonder why, other than inertia, the bow did not replace the firearm again. This gets very complicated. The eventual answer, as we approach the American Civil War, is the rifled musket, since if you have a rifle that can be loaded quickly, as opposed to a Revolutionary War rifle, it has as good range as a bow. It works better in questionable weather. There is the answer. So there are questions on simulations of that sort. The other problem on saying we will do simulation is handling the special cases. So here we are, the Roman army facing the army of Carthage. And the Carthaginians have all of these elephants. And if you are Scipio Africanus, you find a clever solution. You find a herd of pigs. This is very cruel to pigs. You wrap them heavily in cloth. You soak the cloth in lamp oil. And at the appropriate time, you set the pigs, or at least their clothing, on fire, and scream and shout and point at them. And now there is this herd of flaming pigs charging the elephants. Elephants take poorly to surprise, and the elephants did what most people would do if they were charged by a herd of flaming pigs. They turned around and ran very quickly and trampled everything in their path, including one wing of the Carthaginian army. We might also consider on the same line the English infantry unit, which this is at Waterloo, which was invited to hang on to the straps of the English cavalry unit that was going to charge the French. And they were moved with extreme rapidity into firing position. And then the infantry fired at the French, and then the cavalry charged. And the poor French, who didn't think there were any infantry in range, were disordered and then run down by the cavalry. We may also consider, we shall move to the other side of the globe, sometime near the Battle of Sekigahara, and Granny Samori. Japanese women of the noble class were trained in the use of weapons, who was at the top of a tower. And the tower had a narrow staircase arranged so anyone going up the staircase had their sword against the wall, and she had a chain scythe. 27 idiots later, The commander on the ground suggested to her that he was going to fill the tower, at least the bottom of it, with straw, rice straw soaked in oil, and turn the tower into a pillar of fire. And she dutifully, after the demonstration, committed ritual suicide. But you're going to write a rule to cover that accurately? The answer, of course, you can propose is, well, these are the freak events, like the ancient Greek flamethrower that was used to take a city. And most of the time, it was push of pike, and Romans trained to use short sword and fight in good formation. And the normal weapons and tactics are what you need to simulate, because that's in fact what usually won battles. Nonetheless, saying we can simulate things is open to some question. What data do you want have? Which weapons work and when? Which special cases do you need to handle? It gets very difficult. After all, you have vast numbers of people who are just as smart as we are, who are exerting their considerable creative skills to the question of how they are going to turn their opponents into mincemeat in using methods that did not expose them to excessive risk. And people do all sorts of creative things that way. So, for example, you may look at that World War I weapon, the machine gun. First machine gun patent dates to 1740. It wasn't the world's greatest, but you know, creativity works. Okay, having said this, and talked a bit about simulation and why it isn't as possible as you would like, but it can give you good games. And it certainly can give you games with ideas you can stick into computer games. Having said this, we now ask what it is that Charles Roberts did. And so what Roberts said is, well, we have military units, and we will represent the military units with little squares of cardboard. And there's some little marks on the cardboard. And the cardboard, it's like any other, it's like a meeple, but it's a data storage device. So those numbers and marks on the cardboard represent what the military unit is and how strong it is and how far it can move. And now we're going to deal with the movement problem. The problem with movement is that if you just follow H.G. Wells and have toy soldiers on, he used carpets. Actually, they're photographs. And there is H.G. Wells on the carpet using a yardstick to move toy soldiers along. The problem with this is that yardstick movement is not very reproducible. And if I have moved and there's a disagreement as to whether I moved too far or not, it's really hard to check, and the accuracy of the measurement can become, well, questionable. The way we avoid this is gridding. That is, we say we will take the map board and we will break it into squares or any of a lot of other different shapes. And there are very regular geometric shapes, and there are weird geometric shapes. And then, of course, there are opportunities for real artistic creativity where you use an area map. We'll get to area. How many of you have played Risk or seen it played? Well, bunches of you. Those of you who've played Risk have seen an area map. So Robert said, okay, we are going to put down a grid so we can tell where units are and where they move. And the last thing he did, well, not quite the last thing, but the next thing he did is to say, well, we are going to quantify how strong units are, so if we have a battle fought out, we have a way of deciding what is going on. And his way of deciding what was going on had two parts. So here is a unit sitting here on defense. And here, I'm drawing the box slightly differently so you can tell these are units that belong to the other side. And the units, the little cardboard counters on each side have numbers printed on them. And you, what you can do is to say, well, this side has, this unit has a defense strength, that's the second number, 10. And these numbers have attack strength, that's the first number, 8 plus 8 plus 8 plus 6 is 30. So if we ask what is the ratio of the attack strengths to the defense strengths, it's a 30 to 10 or 3 to 1. Now, there obviously have to be some detailed rules behind this because you are, for starters, you are obviously aren't always going to get simple ratios. In the original game, Roberts somewhat solved this because all units either had a strength of 1 or a strength of 2, and life was a lot easier. Okay, so now that we have done this and we found the strength, now we are going to have something that resolves what happens in the battle, and it is called a combat results table. And this is where variable outcomes. You remember what Greg Kostikian said about one of the things that makes a game interesting is variable outcomes? Well, here's the combat results table, and it's going to give us variable outcomes. And the way it works in most standard, you could do it slightly differently, there's some examples in the book, is we have a series of columns labeled 2 to 1, 3 to 1, 4 to 1, and this corresponds to the attacker being stronger and stronger relative to the defender. And then we have rows corresponding to the roll of a die. Now, when this started, we were back in 1958 or 1954, the only dice you could get commercially were D6s, six-sided dice. It was technically possible, if you had contacts in Japan, to procure Japanese Standard Association D20s, labeled 0 through 9 twice. They cost more than some pocket calculators would in current dollars. They were very hard to get, but you could get them if you worked hard enough. And so we have a random number here, and we roll the random number, and over here we have results, such as DE, which is a fancy code, which means we have fought the battle, the defender is eliminated, the defending unit is destroyed, the attacker has won completely. Or we have a result like DB2, defender back 2, the attacker has driven the defending unit back 2 squares as it happens, and therefore the defender, and their rules as to who gets to move the defending unit and how far and where, the defender gets shoved back. Or we have that amusing result, the exchange, E-X-C-H, and the notion of the exchange is what normally happens in battles, namely there is this hideous bloodbath and both sides take losses, and so this is the weaker side. They're wiped out, they lose 10, and the other side has to lose as many, well, at least as many. They can't lose 10, they've got 3 eighths and a 6, so they take losses too, and this is the unpleasant nature of modern warfare. Now, the strategic analysis, the game analysis, is a lot of number crunching. That is, I arranged things so I had a 3-to-1. If I had been less careful, if I just shoved units forward and not thought about what I was doing, I might have been attacking at, say, 1-to-1, in which case, half the time, the attacker's units are simply wiped out without gaining any ground. And therefore, there is a great deal of numerical analysis, and I give examples of this in the Stalingrad book as to how you do the analysis, that show you how you develop and actually get to something that involves skill. It's like any other game. There is skill involved, And because there is skill involved, there is analysis possible. This is true in almost any game that you would care to mention. Let me give a few examples. And so here is a chessboard. And so each side is down to king and one pawn. However, the white pawn is here, headed that way. The black pawn is here, headed that way. White moves, and black is now in very deep trouble. Namely, I better put the black pawn here, headed this way. Namely, the white pawn will get to the eighth row and become a queen, while the black pawn is still here. And now the black pawn, the white queen, will simply move around the board, drive the black king away, and eventually be able to take the black pawn. Now we are down to king and queen against king. Black is sure to lose. Why did this work? The white pawn had to move only two spaces to become a queen. The black pawn, because of where it was placed, had to move one, two, three, four. These are called tempi. And the notion of tempi is that it takes time for things to happen, and if you are in the right place, you have an advantage that can't be beaten. There are plenty of more sophisticated examples in chess that I won't show you. Similarly, here is a small corner of a Go board. And the notion in Go, I am giving the very simple version, is that if you build up a formation of stones that are next to each other, in order to capture any of these stones, what the other side has to do is to move and occupy all of the spaces that are open that those white stones are next to. Well, I've given you a formation where that's impossible. There is no way that black can play to occupy this because white has two separated open spaces. So now, if you have no idea how to play Go at all, you might imagine you set up in a corner and you start playing stones next to each other one at a time where they're mutually self-supporting. And if you try this approach against someone who, even someone as ignorant as I am, you will notice, yeah, I'll play a stone and a stone, and then suddenly I'll jump to over here and over here, and I will make moves out here someplace that where the stone looks a bit isolated. And I am taking advantage of a general strategic strength known as outward influence, which is a very powerful scheme for improving your position. And the notion is that if you put something out a moderate distance, not only does it occupy a space, but it has influence in the areas around it outwards. And this gives you a much more powerful playing position. Indeed, when I was at high school, I would routinely win games against absurd handicaps, not because I'm any good as a player, but because I had the chance to study one top-level game and deduced that outward influence really worked. And the people who didn't quite grasp this as much didn't grab territory as fast. So that's outward influence. The notion in Stalingrad is basically a statistical analysis of different parts of the combat results table where you try to choose your attacks in such a way that you minimize your losses and maximize the other guy's losses. Of course, you might say, gee, is it all combat? Aren't there other things in warfare? And the answer is, yes, there are. And Robert's Tactics 2, first generally sold commercial war game, was actually very sophisticated in the range of rules it had. For example, we have logistics. And the notion of logistics is basically you may be at point X with a military unit, but if you don't have supplies of gasoline and diesel fuel and ammunition and food and water, your unit is not going to be very effective in battle. And as you become more and more modern, the demands for continuous supply get larger and larger. And so what Robert said is, well, here are cities, there are supply points, and if you are out here, you need a supply line that you can trace back to a city showing that you have supply. If you're surrounded, you're out of supply, your combat strength goes down, and after a few turns without food, you surrender. It does not take much time at all to convince people who are cut off from their food supply to surrender. During the Battle of the Bulge at the front end, the German army rolled through. There were a couple of American regiments that were cut off from their field kitchen the first morning, and within a very small number of days, they found it convenient to surrender. It was a very difficult situation. So that's logistics. There is always what is usually called hidden movement or fog of war. I mean, if you are playing a game, you're looking down and you can see everything. And you can see everything in the same sense as if, you had this huge supply of little baby drones flying back and forth, or if you were at the top of a very tall skyscraper where everything is visible from above. But, you know, that isn't very realistic. In fact, under most conditions, most of the time you know where most enemy units are, and the problem is you don't always know where they all are. And in fact, so what Roberts did was to say, okay, well, we have about 44, 45 units on the board, and you may hide the location of seven of them. The seven of them must be a coherent group of units, and there are details in the rule on this, but as long as they're decently behind the front lines where they can't be blundered into, you can just remove them from the board and record on paper where they were. Just hidden movement. Does hidden movement work? Well, we may consider the Bridge Too Far, which Operation Market Garden, this was the paratroop effort to break through the German lines and get into the Netherlands in fall of 44. And the first problem was that it was militarily implausible because it was over too narrow a front. And the second problem was that the paratroops had the problem that we lost track of the location of a number of German tank divisions, and instead of dropping against little or no resistance, they dropped against a great deal of resistance indeed. This is hidden movement. Oh, other example. At some point in November 1941, it should have been apparent that we had completely lost track of the location of all of the Japanese aircraft carriers at the same time. And usually we knew where most of them, or many of them were. And it did not occur to anyone that this was bad news, at least until December 7th, when a bunch of them showed up at Pearl Harbor and sank the core of our Pacific Fleet. Hidden movement, fog of war, can be significant. If you don't have hidden movement, well, half of surprise is seeing what the enemy in principle could do. The other half, though, is anticipating what she will do. And it is perfectly possible, there are examples in both of the Stalingrad books, where the it's usually the Russian player I do this with, makes an unanticipated move and does something very unpleasant to the poor Germans, who get exactly what they deserve given that they were Nazis. And the surprise is not you couldn't see what was happening. The surprise is you didn't anticipate that the enemy could... The Germans did not anticipate that the Russians could converge all of their units on a point and launch an effective counterattack. That's supply. Another issue, this is also in Robert's games, is production, replacement, reinforcements. That is, in an extended war, it will often be the case that you have training camps and factories and all of this other good stuff making units to replace the units that you have managed to get killed and replace the people you have managed to get killed. And this is a very complicated process which can sometimes be simplified a lot. Those of you who have seen 4X space warfare games will have noticed that all of those spaceships showing up, well, that's the evolutionary end that started back in Tactics 2 with the rule that every 3 months each side got a certain number of infantry divisions and a tank division restored from the dead if they still had all of their cities. Okay, so that was something else that Roberts did. Roberts did not do much with what is technically known as command and control. There is this very loose rule that the headquarters units ought to be more or less adjacent to the units that are assigned to their formation. So there's a corps headquarters and there's a half dozen units in the Army Corps, and they should all be kept together and moved as a group. But there are no real penalties or directions on how close is close. It's one of these spiritual guidance rules which doesn't really affect the game so much. Command and control is a point at which computer games tend to break down rather badly. And there are two sorts of ways they break down, which we may describe as planning and doctrine. Planning and doctrine are the opposite of a real-time simulation. RTS, if you are showing one and only one person, you can claim that RTS is vaguely realistic. However, if you're showing either a small or a large group of units, it's not done that way. Real-time is not what is happening. At the large scale, if we are here, the enemy is here, and so I have broken the attacking units into several groups. And here is battle group COD, and battle group COD is supposed to advance to phase line flounder and stop, and battle group tuna is supposed to advance to phase line albacore and stop until phase line tuna is occupied. And then when both sides are here, this group, which is the artillery, is supposed to bombard the enemy, following which there is an overland attack. And you notice this is sequential and it is all planned out in advance in considerable detail. Even though you plan all this stuff out in advance in considerable detail, there are occasional misfortunes. For example, this unit attacks and gets here, and then the artillery opens up on the position just the way they are supposed to, except the position is now being occupied by our side. Or people are supposed to make converging attacks, and these people get lost and head off that way. All these things can happen, but the basis is planned in advance in each of a series of groups have orders, and if it fails, they have the fallback order as to what they're supposed to do if this doesn't work. And all this is actually planned out in detail in advance. This is not real-time simulation where the commander shouts orders at this group and that group and hopes that things happen in some sort of order. That's not the way you do things in the real world. At the bottom end, what you have is doctrine. And doctrine is, for example, we have a platoon going out on a patrol. Fortunately, I missed Vietnam by the skin of my teeth. And so if we have the platoon on patrol, we have a few people out here as point to trigger ambushes, note mines in the road, and other unpleasant things. If the fields are open enough, this will often not be the case. We have people on flank on each side. And all of these people are trained with hand signals, so if you want people to stop or hurry up or whatever, there are gestures that you can make so that everyone can communicate. Of course, different people have different doctrines. For example, if you are doing this in the dark, especially before night vision equipment, the American doctrine, which supposedly came from American Indians ambushing cavalry, was you tried to be very quiet and sneak up on the other guy. The Japanese Army, which was very good at making night attacks in World War II, there was one occasion in which my dad, who was a medical officer, looked at the front of the tent. And coming through the front of the tent, it was a night attack, were several Japanese soldiers with rifles and bayonets. He had a pistol that jammed after one round. He backed very quickly and gracefully out the rear of the tent. However, the Japanese night doctrine was exactly the opposite of ours. You had trumpets and officers shouting and people chanting, and you had lots of noise being made by the attackers. And the reason for this is that while the noise might alert the enemy to what was going on, it would surely reassure your own people that you weren't all alone in the dark by yourself, that you were surrounded by your buddies and you were in a coordinated attack. Japanese thought this was the right way to do things. In any event, suppose the in period this would be Viet Cong. Could also be World War II ambushes, same issue. People sit here and start shooting. In a real-time simulation, I sort of have to tell each of the people in the patrol what they're supposed to do. But if you have doctrine, you don't do that. Instead, and this doctrine is historic, dependent on historical date, you all turn. You let the Viet Cong or the Germans or whatever have a clip at full automatic or as close as you can get, and then you do a not dead run but fairly fast walk forward while shooting at the enemy so he keeps his head down until you're close enough to throw hand grenades at him. The commanding officer, the lieutenant, platoon lieutenant, did not have to give many orders, maybe one. In order to get all this complicated stuff to happen, it's doctrine. Everyone knows what they're supposed to do and they carry it out. You notice this is the opposite of real-time simulation. I'm almost out of time, and so I will stop with the thought. And if you wanted to design a really better combat computer game, you'd design something in which all of those meeple on the board had at least a little brain. However, we are out of time for today, so class is dismissed.